Causons Couture, let's chat about sewing, a creative podcast to talk about our handmade wardrobes and to discover the sewing community with interviews with its personalities, entrepreneurs and actors who inspire us. Hello everyone, I'm Mathilde, creator of this podcast and founder of Atelier Sherwood. I support women who would like to appreciate their wardrobes, who want to be sure of their clothing choices, who want to feel comfortable with their image and who want to find their superwoman colors and clothes. Do you want to feel confident in yourself and express to the world who you are? You want to know more, whether you practice sewing or not? I invite you to book a free, non-obligation discovery call to define your needs together, so that you can discover my way of working and to see if you would like me to accompany you. See you soon and enjoy listening to this episode. To all my listeners, I'm really happy to have Olga with us today. Welcome.
And, hi, Mathilde. Thank you.
Could you tell us who you are?
I've been working at Vicky Souls for over 5 years, and I've started as the general manager when the team was very small. We were like 10 people. Mm-hmm. And later on, I became an international director. So I'm in charge of international business development now.
Okay. So today we are going to talk about this brand, this Russian brand of patterns, which is Vicky Souls. Could you tell us how this brand started in a few words?
Sure. It started around 8 years ago. So Victoria always had a passion for sewing. So since she was a child, she was constantly doing something. I believe she started with the toys, mm-hmm. Making toys. And then later on, she switched onto making clothes. And the brand actually started the whole journey with the sewing pattern started when she went to maternity leave. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she had a little bit of more time for herself and for her hobby, for her passion. So, and at first, as far as I know, I know for sure, she wanted to have a fashion brand, you mm-hmm. know, she wanted to yes. have a little bit of like a small fashion, local fashion brand. So, back then, also at the same time, Instagram was just started gaining traction. Mm-hmm. So, and at the same time, she decided to have her own sewing blog. So she was sewing, right? She was making a little bit of clothes at the same time. When she started to look for the ways to produce clothes mm-hmm. not for the mass market, right? But rather like in a bigger volume than one mm-hmm. Piece. She started looking for sewing patterns and realized that it was super difficult to find the sewing pattern that would be modern and trendy. Mm-hmm. That would be something that, like, you know, you see on the catwalks and stuff like this.
Yeah.
So that's where she had an idea, like, oh, maybe there is a market there. Yeah, maybe there yes. is something that can be improved there. At the same time, because of her blog, and back then, like Instagram, 8 years ago, Instagram, you could grow your blog yeah. organically, right? I'm not sure if you can do that now.
Harder.
So, yeah, exactly. So her blog grew, and she was constantly talking to her audience. And they were all, because she was showing her tips and tricks about sewing and stuff like this, they were mm-hmm. all discussing the same things. And she heard more and more from her followers that something that would confirm her initial idea that it's difficult to find the trendy and modern sewing pattern, mm-hmm. patterns. So that's where she kind of put her idea of the brand a little bit aside and decided to explore the idea of having a sewing pattern brand.
Yes.
Also, at the same time, as far as I know, and she shares that quite a lot with the audience, that
yes.
when she shared the idea with her friends and family, no one was excited about that. They were all saying that, like, oh, it's just a small niche. It's just a hobby for a few people. You can never make anything out of it. You can never make any money out of it. Just forget about that. And only her father was like, try it. If you don't try it, you will never know.
Yes.
So he lended her some money because she had an idea like, okay, if she starts the brand, right, not fashion brand, but sewing pattern brand,
yes.
she needs an office, she needs some employees and stuff like this. That's
yes.
a pretty common mistake for everyone, for most of the people that start their first business. So she and her father lended her some money. It wasn't a big amount back then. It was equivalent of something like $1,000. So she hired the first. She needed a team to help her to bring her idea to life, and she hired a pattern maker and the seamstress, and of course the office. So they had an office. And that's where they started to make the first models, right? And sell them via her Instagram account. That's how it started.
Yeah. And now it's a really big brand, world known. And she started after a few years to sell them in English and to open to the all the world. Because I remember a few French seamstresses doing some Vicky Sue's patterns from Russian using Google Translation.
Yeah.
And
that's exactly how it was, yeah.
Yeah. And now you sell them in English.
Yes. So this is exactly what happened. After a few years, I think I've been in the company for like a year and a half or 2 years, I've started like regularly checking our social networks, our Instagram account, and noticing people saying like, oh guys, can you please help me with this translation? Or people would email us like, because you couldn't just from our PDF instruction, you can't just copy because of the copyright protection, you can't just copy text and paste them in the Google Translate. So people would type it in Russian, trying to understand what's written there. And that's where I came to Vicky and said like, okay, well, people might really need it. If they do, if they go that extra mile, they might really want your patterns. Let's see what we can do about it. And yeah, we had a few ways to validate that idea, and I can share that if you want, because we were quite cautious, like, oh, maybe it's, maybe we were afraid that it's like we are mistaking a few people who wants it for a bigger audience.
Okay, so what did you do?
Because we could like, you know, it's not that complicated and it's not that expensive to translate a few patterns, right? But what was complicated for us is that our website is rather complicated because it's Vicky's first business, right? And she didn't have any experience in the website development. So she came into the first development, she could developers she could find and ask them to create a website for her. But instead of using the like some common platform that you can easily update, they decided to create a, like a custom website. So it worked fine in the beginning, but when you add more and more stuff into it, it became very difficult to maintain. So basically every single step, every single action cost us quite a lot of money. So, and we knew that if we want to have a second language, if we want to have products on a different languages with the different markets, it's going to cost us money. So it's not sort of MVP, right? We can invest it and not gain anything back. So that's where I decided to explore, like, how can we validate that idea that there is a bigger market rather than the few seamstress that likes our sewing patterns. And that's where the idea of having an Etsy, selling the patterns on Etsy came into life. So we decided, okay, let's translate it. Let's not do anything with our current website. Let's try to sell them via Etsy, see if there is. Because on the Etsy, basically, the, there are people that don't know us, right?
Yes.
If we can put a few things together, correct description, correct sewing text, people are going to discover us somehow and organically, and we see if we like, if they like it.
Okay.
So that's how we made it. We translated the first 20, I think 20 patterns. It was our best sellers in the Russian market, and put them on Etsy. And like gradually updating a few things, getting a little bit of help with the account, we started seeing sales.
Mm-hmm.
And then like in about a month or two, after the first sales and the first reviews from the people that never knew us, it was clear that yeah, we can proceed with a longer vision, with translating the website and with bringing more products to international market.
So do you still sell on Etsy?
Yes, we do.
Okay, and you made the work for your website to be upgraded or changed, and now you can have all in English and to sell in English too.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think it took us about like 4 months to show how complicated it was. That, and like you have to be very careful selecting the developers if it's your first website, because you can get trapped. Yes, now we sell on two languages, Russian and English.
And do you sell all your patterns in English? And when you start the new collection now, do you translate all at the same time as you sell in Russian?
So we didn't, because I think we already had a collection of like 300 patterns in Russian when we started. Mm-hmm. So of course we didn't translate all of them. So mm-hmm. we picked the best sellers. We picked that new is gonna work for longer. That is gonna stay trendy. That is gonna stay modern for couple of years ahead, or mm-hmm. that were like pretty classic. Some old patterns are not translated, and we still get the emails from customers saying like, "Oh, could you please translate that pattern?" But with the current collection, yes, we try to translate everything. Sometimes it is complicated because we first need to. So it comes with a little bit of backlog.
Mm-hmm.
It comes like 2 weeks later after the initial release. And sometimes we see that, for example, the outerwear mm-hmm. is not selling that well, right? Because of the country, because some of our clients live in a warmer climate, yes. And they just don't need it. I had a few customers interviews with the customers, and they were saying, "Oh, I love your coats, but I'm never gonna wear a coat because in the place where I live, it's like plus 30 all year round."
Yes. And what is the aesthetic of the Vikisu? How do you tell the fashion aesthetic of the patterns?
So I would say, and that's what our clients also say, and that's what they actually read our ideas quite well, is that we try to bring on the market something that is currently trendy, but not the micro trends, right?
Mm-hmm.
Not things that will become outdated in a few months,
yes.
But rather those long lasting trends and classic designs.
Yes.
So the Vicky and the team, the designer she works with, but basically it's her vision. So she watches trend shows, catwalks, and so we get inspired by the like silhouettes, shapes, and stuff like this.
Yeah. And would you say there is some distinction between fashion in Russia than in the US or in Europe? Or do you think there is some different aesthetics?
I honestly, because I also live abroad,
mm-hmm.
I used to live in London, I live in Europe now, I don't see it, maybe because I'm not, you know, I'm more into the on the business mm-hmm. side of things. Even I'm sewing myself, it's my hobby,
mm-hmm.
So I do it both for work and for hobby. I can't see a big difference. Maybe there is a slight twist on things,
mm-hmm.
I would say. But when we're talking about the silhouettes, right, shapes, colors, I don't see much difference. But I'm not the best person to ask, to be honest.
Okay. And do you choose which pattern you're going to translate? Now you translate them all, but
yeah.
Was there some design you said, okay, no, it's not for Europe or US or English world? It's only, it's typical Russian woman would wear.
We well, as I mentioned before, like sometimes if it is, it's a big collection of, let's say, the winter collection, we choose very carefully because it costs money and quite a lot of money to translate every single pattern. So that's where we are more careful and we say, okay, we have quite a lot of clients living in a warmer climate and they just simply don't need it. That's where we try to be more careful. Yes, sometimes we see that maybe some of our, I remember last year we had a cruise collection and fun story. I don't think that those two patterns were actually very popular on the Russian markets as well. There was like a, you know, like a bandeau top, like really like just a few pieces of fabric around your breast, I would say. So, and the same kind of skirt. I don't think it was popular on the Russian market, but we decided to translate it. And I brought those patterns to knitting and stitching show in London. So we had it hanging on the wall. And I saw people like pointing fingers at them and discussing that it's like a little bit, maybe it was a bit too much or a bit too open, stuff like this.
Okay.
Yeah. So it was quite funny. That's where I was like, okay, maybe we need to think more careful sometimes.
Yes. And would you say when you draft your patterns, do you draft them all the same, and when for the English translation, is it only translation or do you redraft the patterns?
No, we do not redraft it. It's a translation of words that we put in the pattern, and the sewing instructions. So we do not redraft them.
And do you draft according to some Russian numbers of the woman stature?
You mean standards?
Yes.
Actually, we do not use the particular standards. Yes, there are of course standards on the for the industry, but we don't use them. We use because all our pattern drafters, pattern makers, they're very experienced. So we like together with them, we came up with our own measurement table. We say, like, okay. We think that 38, for example, should be this measurement. It's more realistic than the pattern, than the industry standards at the moment.
Okay.
So it's our own pattern drafter experience.
Okay. And on the experience of sewing, do you think there is a difference between Russian sewists and all the rest of the world sewists? Is this some culture of the sewing hobby or making their own clothes?
What I can say is that, and I know it's not only in Russia, there are also the it was in some countries in Europe, but in Russia we had and I think it's the whole Eastern Europe, we had like technology lessons at school. So when we were at school, we learned how to sew, meaning that you are maybe a little bit more familiar with the sewing machine than the person who didn't have those lessons, right? So you know you are not afraid of it. You know what it is. You know what it is for. You know how to put the thread through it and start doing the basic stuff. It helps, of course. With our international audience, I see that they are more excited about just getting the results. Instead of thinking, oh, you know, this stitch is not perfect, I'm not going to wear it, because and it's quite encouraging, because yes, you get better over time if you drop your project because something is not perfect, right? Means you have less and less enthusiasm to continue.
Yes.
So that's what actually happened to me many times, because as I mentioned, this is my hobby, and I've never learned, besides having some lessons at school and learning from actually from Vicky Sew's patterns, that's my education. And sometimes I see that like, oh, it didn't came up as pretty as I expected. I'm not going to wear it, which is very discouraging for me. And then that's where I'm thinking, like, why do I do it for myself? I invested my time. I invested my money into buying fabrics,
yes.
Right? And if I'm not going to wear it now, then what? So with the international audience, again, because I had a chance to talk to like around 20 of our clients, mm-hmm. having sort of the same interview, asking them why they choose our patterns, what do they like about mm-hmm. other patterns. So, and they, I had a question about like what percentage of your makings you actually wear. Mm-hmm. And they all say like almost everything, 90%, 85%, which was very interesting for me, because for me personally, it's maybe half, because then I finish it and I say, oh, I don't like how it came out. but they actually wear it. That's exciting.
And you don't wear it because of the fit or the look, or because, like you said, it's not as polished as you wanted it to be?
Yeah, for me personally, because I know that it's not polished as I would like it to be. And even if it's not visible, I know that on the inside, it doesn't look like I want it. And you know, I'm maybe not the standard person here, but I'm like, oh, I know it, so no.
So on you have two Instagram accounts, one in Russia and one in English, and you don't yes. share the same tips or the same tutorials and the same things. Is it material you do just for the internationals different, or is it a mix match of things and you don't publish at the same time?
No, we actually, yes, the content is different, because what we noticed is that our international audience, for example, likes like sewing tips and tricks mm-hmm. more than something else. Our Russian audience like, for example, styling tips, how to style this dress, yeah, what you can wear it with, and international audience is more about like particular tips and tricks.
Okay, like more how I do it, and the other yeah. one is how I wear it.
Yes.
And it's funny because I went on your blog and there is a lot of tricks, and there is few like look what was on the red carpet and
yeah.
fashion observation and what are the micro trends, and I love the mob wife things.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So is it Vicky that do Victoria that do does it, or is it someone watching with her and chatting with the team?
Well, it used to be, I think, in the beginning, when the company started, right, it used to be Vicky who was leading the blog, and it was all the content was her ideas. Mm-hmm. And of course, now we are a bigger team, and she's responsible for the product. She's responsible for the designs.
Mm-hmm.
She's responsible for the courses. Basically for creating the products,
yes.
Right? And she has a team that helps her with content, Instagram, other social
sure.
medias, but she's still quite involved. So we're like, for example, I've just came from the meeting with the marketing team where mm-hmm. we discussed the content for the international account,
mm-hmm.
how we're going to present this product, how we want to present that product, what we're going to post, and stuff like this.
And so, yes, as you said, you have courses. Could you tell us what they are and what they offer?
Yeah, sure. So we have so-called sew-alongs,
mm-hmm.
right? When we show you when there is a pattern, there is a particular pattern, and instead of using PDF instruction, we have a very detailed video, so
mm-hmm.
you can follow every step and get the result. We started with that. Now we are switching more onto, we have two bigger
mm-hmm.
courses. We have a bag making course. There are
mm-hmm.
four bags included. And now there is another exciting thing coming onto our website is the wedding dress course.
Yeah, so it...
so there is, yeah, we're running the pre-sale now. There are three dresses with the detailed videos, mm-hmm. and over, I think, around 10 other dress patterns.
Okay.
Something that comes with a PDF instruction.
Okay. So like this, you can mix and match patterns and do your own wedding dress?
You can mix and match. You can take the pattern that you like, right, without changing anything, right, and just follow the video and create and make it, or you can mix and match, or you can just slightly update, like hack the pattern a mm-hmm. little, so that's up to you.
And you have fabrics, and do you have haberdashery or no? Just fabrics?
We have fabrics and haberdashery. Yes, it's more like for the our bigger sewing courses. In Russian, we have a course for, like, we call it the basic one. Mm-hmm. So where you learn how to sew, yeah, or upgrade your skills. So we can also offer you, for example, there are five different models. The dress, so you learn how to sew the dress, mm-hmm. pants, skirt, blazer, and coat, I believe. So you can choose to either go to the shop and buy the fabrics that you like, okay. or we can offer you the whole set.
Okay.
Actually, the whole idea, I really like that idea. I think we need to put more attention, more attention to it, because not all our clients know mm-hmm. that actually with one click on the website, they can buy the whole set. So they don't need to think about, like, when you buy the fabrics, like, you need other haberdashery notions and so on and so forth. So with one button, you can say, I'm gonna sew this this pattern, mm-hmm. I need this fabric, and everything comes together with the fabric. We will put the right amount of buttons,
yes.
to make that model. We'll put the right amount of other things that you need.
Yes, thread, zipper, and everything.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like a box.
Yeah.
Could we buy it from the international market, or is it only Russian?
For now, it's all, I think we do deliver with DHL, as far as I know. I need to ask my team. Not that many into our international clients buy it, and I don't think that we actually presented that product correctly yet. Because as I said, even in Russia, not all our clients know that we offer it. So that's something that we're going to work on later.
Yes. Without talking about politics, but there is an environment of what it is today in the world.
Yeah.
Does it influence how you work on, or how you choose to work for international? Or does it change things for you in the sales or in the option you make?
Yeah, of course, it had a very big impact on us, and it's very sad what's happening. I'm very, very sad about everything that is happening in the world now, and that my country is involved in on that side of things. So when it started, we actually still have employees from Ukraine, for example, that's mm-hmm. From customer service and marketing. So in the beginning, we were very worried about them, but they're all safe now. And then, yes, it had a very big impact on us because the payment systems were mm-hmm. switched off. So we had to come up with a whole, but we still had clients. We had some clients that were saying, sorry, I cannot buy your products. And mm-hmm. it's fair enough, you know.
Yeah.
But we still had international clients asking us, I mean, in the beginning, now it's more like settled with the business part.
Yes.
We had international clients asking, like, guys, how can I continue buying your products? Because
yes.
I like it. I understand that you have nothing to do with it. You're a pattern making company. but yeah, it had both impact on the a moral side of things for the team and for us,
yes.
Right? To the business side of things, where we lost sales for like over 3 months, I believe. We didn't have any international sales while we were figuring out how we can continue selling patterns. And it's completely, like entirely legal, because I sometimes see on Reddit, on other forums, people discussing like, oh, how do they do that? They shouldn't be allowed. We are, and without talking to the moral moral part of things, sure. Right? Technically, there is no sanctions or no ban on selling the products like this.
Okay.
So, yeah.
How many people works for Vikisus today?
Today, the team, like the both international and team here in Russia, it's around with the freelancers, because we have lots of freelancers.
Okay.
We can't, like, there is no point of hiring, for example, the translator, right?
Yes.
That wants to work freelance. I think with the freelancers, we are around 80 people now on the team.
Wow. It's amazing.
Yeah.
And in they don't work all in Russia. So you work.
No, we are all over the world. Moreover, they don't work in the same office because Vicky's initial idea was like, okay, running an office. I think once she rented the first office, she realized that running an office is rather complicated and expensive. So she was more thinking about like, oh, how can we do that without having to work in the same place. It's not only because of the cost. First of all, it's because of the talents you can attract,
yes.
Right? It's if you live in the small city, know where it is, you're limited to the amount, like to the number of talents you can get. But in case you're when you decided that you can run the business remotely, so you have the whole world.
You open.
Yeah, exactly. So that's why most of our, of course, we have an office, and of course, we have employees working from the office, pattern makers, the team that needs to be together all the time,
yes.
To get the results quicker and in a better way. But most of the team, marketing team, content makers, translators, accountants, we all work remotely. And here where COVID helped us quite a lot, right?
Yes.
Because people adjusted to it. And I think it's quite efficient. But I would never say that before, because I used to work in a rather more traditional business environment. Mm-hmm. But now I see that you still can be very efficient if you work from the place where you live.
Yes, and it's funny because I'm speaking for France, but there was so much remote work, and then time by time the bosses told no, stop.
Yeah,
and now so. It's sad because they said before they said no, it's not possible. After they said we have to because with COVID we had to, and now they said no, it's better without. But everybody knows that it's possible to be efficient at home or at some other places than the workplace.
It is absolutely possible, and of course we try to see each other more often. I mean, with the management, like last year around the end of the year, we had a strategy session where we spent 3 days together discussing the strategy, what we do next, what our vision for the future, what kind of products we should have, and when you stuff like this, more strategic, that's where it helps to be together. But daily operational job you can do from home for sure.
Yes, I watched a video of Victoria explaining her story and how she launched the business, and it's funny because she's not coming from the business side of things, and she's starting the company like everybody would try to start something. And then she said she hired a coach and she tried to think as marketing and everything. Now she is really in, she's with the fashion, with the trend, and giving the aesthetic of the brand. But she's too working really as business
entrepreneur thinking about, like you said, strategy, marketing and everything. Is it a big thing in this company or how she think about the business?
She's a true leader and mm-hmm. she's very inspiring and I love seeing her development. I love seeing her growing as an entrepreneur as well. Mm-hmm. Because 5 years ago when I joined the company, I can't say she was thinking differently. She was always excited about her business and she always strived to make it work and mm-hmm. work better. And that's actually when I joined, because I joined the project when there were just the 10 people, mm-hmm. right? And I come from the big corporate environment. Okay. And when I had an interview with her, basically the how I joined the company, I was on maternity leave and I had more time for my hobby, which was sewing. That's when I discovered her blog. And I was like, wow, something is making really cool in this industry. I need to start again, because for a long period of time I wasn't sewing, so I put it on hold. And then I was like, oh, hold on, that's interesting. I was following her blog for a couple of months when they published their ads that they need a manager, mm-hmm. a general manager to come and help them with the business processes set up. And that's actually my specialty. So before, in the corporate world, I was helping companies to set up their business processes, like optimization, automation, and this stuff, this kind of things. So I replied that I can come and help, that I have a similar background and mm-hmm. experience. And I was very exciting when I was talking to it was very exciting when I was talking to her. And I saw that even having just the 10 employees, she thinks that she can only continue if all the business processes are clear, set up, optimized, and work just fine. So I was like, wow, where tell me, without having a business background, where did you hear about the business processes that it should be done? Because I know many successful entrepreneurs that are running their businesses for like 10 years or over, and they never thought about it. Mm-hmm. It's a mess in the company, but it's like some sort of organic mess. So that's where she told me, like, I want to make it succeed. And when I want to make it succeed, when I don't know something, I go and ask. And successful friends, mm-hmm. someone from the family told her that first deal with that, set it up, it will help you to grow.
Yeah. Yeah, you to make a business successful, you have to think about it, but not like it's not only sewing, and it's not only pattern making, it's business and how to organize everything well.
Yeah. So it's a magic, right, of having a right product and the vision for the yes. market. And then it's a daily job of having marketing, business processes, customer service. And it should work together. One doesn't work without another in business.
Could you tell us about your last collections? It's underwears. You never did this before.
No, we didn't. We used to have a course in Russian, but it wasn't sewing patterns. So we taught how to draft the pattern for the patterns for the underwear. It was a couple of years ago. We stopped running it after a while. So, and it's the first collection of sewing patterns. We thought, first of all, it's quite cool. What personally I like that is quite, I find that being quite cool is that it's not quite a big thing. It's something rather small you can try. There are many patterns that are suitable for beginners, mm-hmm. which is also important. They're quite easy, so you can get results quicker. There are no complicated steps there. So that's what I like about that collection. And of course, yeah, we try to come more with the, like, not just the standard collection. Even in our production schedule, we mm-hmm. have that, like, okay, this is like a standards, let's say spring collection of blazers, trousers, skirts, and we try to put the same month something rather special, like underwear, men's collections, wedding collection. So it is interesting for the team, yeah, plus the whole collection of patterns is rather big, and it becomes sometimes difficult to come up with a, I don't know, 20th skirt.
Yes.
When you already have 19th.
How many patterns do you release per year?
We release one or two collections a month, which is each collection is like 8-10 patterns. So it makes it about 20 a month. So around 200.
Wow. And you continue to grow. Do you keep the old ones or do you remake them better or like new to your new standards, or do you stop them completely?
We keep all of them. Sometimes, of course, first of all, if we hear from our customers that something doesn't quite work, mm-hmm. right, we will remake them. We will revisit. We see what the problem is. We will apply the corrections and upload the new files. So all our clients who previously bought it can also have an access to the new ones.
Okay.
Then sometimes we update our patterns. For example, we have a sati skirt. It's a satin skirt cut on bias.
Okay.
Right. It's our best seller. We have had it for like 5 or 6 years.
Okay.
And it's still quite trendy. What the one thing that we made it longer. So because the more trendy length now is something that like almost covers your
ankles.
Legs. So we just we just made it longer. So sometimes we do update them if we see that just a slight touch will make it better.
Okay. In France, we kind of fight the fast fashion these days, not to buy too many garments from far away and not well made and not well paid people all the way. And we fight against having some brands that release a collection every once a week or once a month. Do you think you do a lot and it's what people are waiting for, or do you think you want to keep this path, this way, or do you think it's a lot or not, or do you want to something more slow, or is it
mm-hmm.
how do you envision?
I actually think that pattern making brands contribute to slow fashion more than any other fashion brands, for example, right? First of all, we don't produce in that mass. We don't have to use, we don't have to use the fabric. We don't have to use the resources, right, to
yes.
produce it. It's more for, because, you know, people like when they have something to choose from. People
okay.
like the variety. People, someone will find that like, okay, because sometimes our clients say, we always, when we release the collection, we always ask, what did you choose for yourself? Which one do you like? Which one are you going to buy? Which one are you going to make? And sometimes people say, oh, nothing from this collection. We say, okay, we have 300 more you can choose from once you
yes.
want to make something. So of course you don't have to, I don't think it contributes to the fast fashion in any way, but rather on the opposite side of things.
Yes, for the people to take time to choose what they really want.
Yeah, exactly. Plus, yes, you can buy basically the pattern of like imagine you want to make pants and you have reference somewhere from the Pinterest,
mm-hmm.
right? You can take the like standard draft and apply the correction. Maybe it's going to work. Maybe it's not going to work.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on the knowledge that you have. Or you can find something that is very close to the reference that you have. You can actually even email us your reference and ask what adjustments you need to make in the pattern so you get the same results. But basically, you have more shapes to choose from that is closer to the reference, that is closer to the final idea you want to get.
Okay. Yes, I saw on the website a video where you explain how to make it fit for yourself according to your measurements. And it's really nice because it's not just grading from one size to another. And I saw a dress with few darts, and you explain very well how to split the amount of centimeters you have more or mm-hmm. less on the darts. And it's really more advanced of what we see most of the time. And it's I liked that the girl who shows who made was on the video, and she told like you can keep the design as it if your measurements are different, but it's going to change the silhouette and what you see. And it's I think it's yep. something important. And sometimes I think. I don't, when I teach sewing class, people don't know enough, and it's nice you say it because you sell some silhouette and some how it hang on the people who show the garment.
Yeah.
And if we see, we want exactly the same thing, we need to have exact same ease everywhere yeah. and the same fabric. Like if it's drape or if it's like stiff or everything. And it's nice to be sure to follow this to have the same silhouette.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we haven't, all of us who are doing it as a hobby, haven't chosen the simplest hobby in the world. So, you need to know, but also it gives you a room for development, right? For the constant
sure.
development of your skills, yeah.
Sure. And so you have a lot of dresses, like for like ball gown
yeah.
or
yeah.
really, really chic dresses, because it's one, it's kind of your, like your signature, something really punchy, like really nice color, like that pops a lot, and really nice details on all your garments. Do you have some like really basics, or is it not something you want to have in your catalogs and you really prefer to work on some show off patterns?
We do have a basic as well. Maybe like latest collections were more this kind of chic and what you explained, but we do. There, it was never an idea to have a only, you know, chic evening dresses or something that is that stands out. It was never an idea. We actually, maybe because we have a variety of products.
Yes.
Sometimes difficult to scroll to the end, and the first the website is organized in the way that first you see the latest patterns, but you can apply not many clients know, unfortunately, but there is, when you go to the any pattern section, there is a filter. So you click on a button and the filter appears, and you can choose even the style. But I'm now in the all pattern section on the website. So if you click filter in the top right corner, the filters are going to pop up and you can choose the basic dresses, for example. And it's going to show you all the basic dresses that we have.
Yes. And in the categories, you have homeware and lingerie, the dresses, wedding and evening looks, pants and shirts, skirts, blazer and vests, free patterns for kids, for knits. Two outwear, hoodies, accessory. You make patterns for all the family, men's and kids.
Yes.
We have height, like what height you are.
Yeah.
It could go to 184 centimeters. So it's good for the tall people to know. The silhouette too, and it's the silhouette of the clothing. It's not your silhouette.
Yep.
You have type of sleeves.
Yep.
If you like sleeves. And one particularity of your patterns are you buy only a size.
Yeah.
Why did you choose this way of doing?
Long story. Let me tell you the story, because I heard that question so many times.
Yes.
And if it was up to me, I would give our clients all the sizes they need, because I know that the international public, our international audience used to buy the patterns from the from the other designers, and they would get all the sizes. When we realized that it was never like this for the Russian market, all the producers here, they would sell one size.
Okay.
That's how our software is like, basically the software gives you one size, one height,
okay,
one height group. So when we started to sell on the international market, I started to hear from our client that, oh guys, why can't you do this? And I started digging up into this, and actually it's a software problem for us for now. So it's just, we really tried, because it's not that we are greedy or something. I want to give our clients what they need, right, and what they want, what they used to. I want them to feel that when they pay for the pattern, they get everything they need. There is no that feeling like, oh, if I need a bigger size, I need to buy another size. If I really like it and want to make it for my friend or family, mm-hmm. I need to pay again. No, this is not the case. The case is the software that basically, in order to have all the patterns nested on one sheet, it's a manual work for us for now.
Wow.
So yeah, we tried. It takes enormous amount of time of the team, the pattern makers, mm-hmm. and when they are doing that, they are not making a new pattern. So
sure.
We are really looking into this. Our software, the software that we use, the company, they know about that issue. They said yes, we had our clients asking us for the same thing. Maybe the next release, we're going to see, we really have it on the list for the development for 2024. Maybe as soon as we can do that automatically without having enormous amount of manual work, we're going to make it. But for now, we also at the same time running sometimes quite often running promotions and discounts where you can buy it cheaper, so it's cheaper to buy a few sizes with a discount.
Yes, because if you are between two sizes, it's complicated, or if you don't know what size to choose, it's hard. Or if you gain weight, you're like, ooh.
There are many situations where you might need another size, right? You want to make it for someone else. You really liked it. You gained some weight. You lost some weight.
Yes.
You are between sizes. For the people between sizes, we really try to. There is an information. There is an article on our blog how mm-hmm. you can, as what we discussed previously, right? What adjustments you can apply in order to have your patterns for your particular measurements.
Yes. Do you give the finished measurement pattern information?
We give the size, right, the measurements, for the size plus mm-hmm. the wearing ease.
Yes. So you talk about the ease. Okay. Is there something you would share to our French or international audience here?
Well, I just wanted to say that, well, first of all, thank you very much, Mathilde, for inviting me. It was very exciting to talk to you about the business and about the personal stuff. What I wanted to share, that we have more products coming. We are really concentrating this year on the online courses and how mm-hmm. we can help our audience to get the better results.
Yes.
Right, to do it faster, to get the better results. We're gonna teach you some tricks from our professionals team that they apply every day, and to get the outstanding result, perfect finish, like finishing techniques, couture things, and stuff like this. And one more thing I wanted to share, because we were talking about business so much, right?
Mm-hmm.
I know that maybe not every woman that is sewing thinking about that, but I know quite well that there are many of us who are thinking like, oh, maybe one day I can do something about with my hobby mm-hmm. rather than having it as a hobby, right?
Yes.
Small business, something. What I noticed is that many of our clients don't know that we, and it's written in every instruction that we allow you to use our patterns to produce the clothes for your brand, for example.
Wow.
To use it, so if you're thinking about starting your brand, or if you're thinking about working with the private customers, right? You can please feel free to use our patterns without any hesitation. Of course, you're not allowed to resell it,
yes,
but to use it to produce the collections.
Not as a pattern. You can use it to make clothes you sell, but not to resell the patterns.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. That's correct.
Yes, and you have, I know Victoria makes classes to business, sewing business people too.
Yeah, because Victoria, she has a like very big community that is watching her succeed mm-hmm. in this kind of business. And of course, she's a sort of like... people, the person they admire. So the small, we have a classes that we where we talk about business, what it is, how to make it succeed, what it takes, like helping people to work on their ideas. We do.
Okay, great. So if you want some inspiration, you can follow Vicky Sue's blog and how they grow and how they do wonderful things. And if you want to follow some fashion information, follow the blog too. You have so three accounts on Instagram. You have the international one, which is
just Vicky Sews.
Okay, the Russian one, if you want to try your Russian.
Vicky Sews patterns. Vicky Sews, yeah, _ patterns.
And you can see. What you have as fabrics too?
Yeah, it's Vicky Sews Fabrics.
Yes, perfect.
The account is Vicky Sews Fabrics, yeah.
And the website.
And we're gonna, the website, and for this year, we're gonna launch the our YouTube account in English.
Wow.
And we are also entertaining the idea of having a TikTok for the younger audience.
In the meantime, you can follow the Russian one. YouTube channel, and you can make a subtitle. I went to automatic translation in English. I don't know if it's working in French, but at least you can have some information on Victoria's journey and few. She made a few interviews with other business owner of sewing industry too.
Yeah, that's correct.
And a few tricks and tips you can have. Lots of wonderful information, because you have a lot of people really sewing, and you have this customer service really important, and we email you or we DM you. Is it better to email you or DM you?
Anyway, it's better, whichever you prefer. So you can email any questions that you have related to the products, related to working with the pattern. If you need a help with adjustments, if you need a help, something that went wrong during sewing, please send us your photos or
feedback.
Any other information, your feedback. Yeah, you can email us on info@vickysews.com. Or you can DM us on in our Instagram account. You can, I think there is a WhatsApp on the website.
Mm-hmm.
So it all goes to the customer service, and they deal with it quite well within the short period of time.
Okay. And most of your patterns are on PDF, but you sell them in paper too?
Yes, we do sell them on Amazon.
Okay.
We sell them on Amazon. Not the entire collection goes
okay.
as a paper pattern because of many other reasons, but you can buy it on Amazon in the US. You can buy it on Amazon in the UK. We are bringing it to the Amazon Germany, so you can access it in the whole Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have a partners reselling our patterns in the UK. It's Minerva.com. The fold line. You can buy them on the fold line. So Essentials and Croft Mills and some other smaller suppliers.
Great. And on PDF on your website.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much, Olga, to taking the time for us to be here today and share Vicky Sue's adventure and what it's today. Wish you the best.
Yeah, thank you, Mathilde. It was my pleasure talking to you today.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah, cheers.
I am an image coach and I like working with seamstresses. Are you looking for an adventure from which you will image transformed? With sisterhood and kindness? I offer group support over 4 weeks to discover your body, find your
colors and your style, and above all, feel in harmony with your clothes. Want to know more? Book a free, non-obligation discovery call for me on my website. Find me on www.ateliersherwood.fr, Pinterest or Instagram at Atelier Sherwood. It was Causons Couture with Mathilde and Olga. Thank you very much. See you soon and happy sewing!